is Clean Radio.
Welcome everybody out there listening to Clean Radio. My co-host with the most, Andrew Spanswick, is back in studio with me tonight. Andrew has been helping people in the industry of mental illness and drug addiction for a long, long time.
Yes, you always make me sound old at the beginning of every show.
No, but you've been doing this for, you know, you could do things for a long time and not be old. Like our guest tonight has been playing music for many, many years, and he's very young. And wow. I'd like to welcome everybody to Clean Radio.
Our hashtag, that's an insult, I think. I don't know. I'm trying to figure
out. Hashtag tonight is Rockers in Recovery. And we have a great show. Go to facebook.com/clean radio. Post your comments. Go to @clean radio. There's something I want to talk about. It had a really big impact on me before we get a guest. It happened on Friday. Friday morning. A lot of mornings, Andrew, we're inundated with many people asking for help.
Yep.
And I got a call Friday morning asking... a friend of mine asked if I could do something about a girl. You know, she had a problem with heroin, and I started getting involved with the family. We had about 2 hours to get this person into treatment, you know, from the time her family was going to pick her up in a different state to, and I said, I'll do the best I can. I honestly, it's one of those scary things that we face all the time. We have a few hours sometimes to literally get somebody into treatment. And I walked in, you know, into the office. We were all in the office on Friday. I spoke to you about the situation. You said, get whatever you need to get done. Get her in. Right. And I was able to email the mom on the plane. And about an hour and a half later, she was in.
It's pretty cool.
And it's an amazing thing. And to the people out there that are listening, you know, one of the things we're going to talk about tonight is raising the bottom. And how do we prevent you from, not everybody has to lose everything. There's this old myth that it's the alcoholic, you know, the drug addict, you have to lose the house, you have to lose the wife, you have to lose the job. And they talk about that bottom.
Well, it's not completely a myth. No. It just doesn't apply to everyone.
It doesn't apply to everybody. Yeah. And that's my question to you. How do we raise the bottom for people? How do we make it that, and what is a bottom?
Right. I think, you know, first, most listeners probably don't really understand that whole concept. Yeah. And it's a concept used a lot by interventionists where the idea is people have to hit rock bottom. And that's where it sort of comes from. Lose everything, lose their life and, you know, hit some sort of spiritual plane where they're just broken and they can't do anything else. And they just give in to the idea that they actually have to get sober and then they seek treatment. Concepts now are that people don't actually have to become full-blown alcoholics or addicts to actually get help for even just drug use or abuse. They might not even be a full drug addict yet, but they might be abusing drugs, and that might be enough to actually, you know, make an intervention something worthwhile. And we're seeing younger and younger people get sober earlier and earlier that are having addictive behaviors, but maybe not or fully alcoholics or drug addicts.
It's like full-blown alcoholism or addiction.
Yeah, it's early intervention, and it's, you know, trying to stop people from, you know, causing really bad physical damage to themselves or mental damage or also, you know, material damage even.
So if you're out there and you're listening, and I beg of you, you know, we've had people that have listened to the show drunk that have called... you know, 90 days sober.
I know, we had a little thing about that. I was like, Judah, you know, a lot of people out there are listening to our show are drinking and using drugs.
I made a call for, you know, I said, if that's happened, Rich in Tampa called in and told us about a month ago he had 90 days sober. He's still doing great.
Right.
And so if you're out there, we don't, just, there is hope. Give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. To all you Washington fans out there, we're going to actually be... I'm going to be in Washington State this coming Friday for an event we're helping sponsors called Rockers in Recovery. Yeah. We're going to be in Aberdeen, Washington. And
Novoselic.
What?
I forget. It was a Nirvana joke. You didn't get it.
I didn't get it. So we're going to be there. Our hashtag tonight is Rockers in Recovery. And one of the things, we actually have an amazing rocker in studio tonight, and he made me say, because our regular caller, Todd, who calls from Salem, Oregon. Oh, here's our rocker. Do it. I want to hear it. I can't even do this cool. And that's our guest tonight is Wil-Dog Abers from the band Ozomatli. Welcome to Clean Radio, Will.
Hey, hello.
Yeah, our sound man was...
Hang the DJ. Hello. Yeah, right.
Hang the DJ.
Well, I tried dancing with the music. I'm, you know, and actually, it's supposedly you're an amazing break dancer. I'm remiss. I'm scared to say.
Judah Dance actually has been out of favor lately.
Yes. I'm actually a little scared to say it because I read it on Wikipedia and I found out so much of your Wikipedia page is not true.
Well, I would say I'm an amazing breakdancer, but I did breakdance as a child, and I did my best. Am I on here?
Yes, you are.
Okay, yeah, it's good. Just okay. Yeah.
Welcome to Clean Radio, Wil-Dog Abers.
You know what's interesting about what you were saying? I forgot your name.
Andrew.
Andrew, thank
you. Okay.
Sorry, Andrew.
It's a rocker. That's what happens.
Yeah, right? And
they're like, you're if not, I'm important.
They're like some hot Latino chick. It would have been like, oh, yeah.
Hey, Sandra.
Yeah, right.
Or Andrea.
Yeah.
All right, this is going too far.
I wish I would have known that I could have gotten help before I became a crackhead, you know?
Right. Yeah.
I knew I was a crackhead prior, you know, when I was a child. I knew that I was going to be a crackhead, and I knew, and I had this vision of myself of pushing a shopping cart down the street.
Really?
And being homeless. Yeah.
Do you think that was like a self-fulfilling prophecy to some degree, or?
When I was growing up, we were homeless at a certain time in my life in junior high. I was living basically from Skid Row all the way down Venice to Venice Beach, anywhere in between. We were called homers at that time.
What year was that? That was...
Oh, man. See, now Venice I'm not was... showing that I'm young.
Yeah.
So you're a young guy.
Yeah. That was 80...
So things were still rough, let's say, in Venice. It wasn't the Venice that people know now.
Yeah, I don't know what it's like now. I have no idea what it's like.
Yeah, it's kind of touristy and very expensive.
I go down there as a tourist now, yeah.
But it was a lot of gangs there, right?
Yeah.
A lot of the industry had pulled out of Southern California.
I mean, well, there was gangs all over L.A., you know? I mean, I lived in from MacArthur Park all the way to Venice Beach, anywhere in between.
So you had to change your shirt like 5 times, different color, just to get across town?
Or? I mean, I was an artist. I was a musician, so I was part of that crew of kids that were skaters and artists. We knew some of those guys, but we didn't, like...
When did the actual drugs come into place?
Probably when I was about 13. When I actually, you know, smoked the greatest joint of my life, you know, at that time.
And chased that joint for a long time.
It was awesome. Yeah. It was great. It was wonderful.
And if you just tuned in, you are listening to Clean Radio. And you know why it's important we talk about that? Because, and Andrew and I have spoken about this, a lot of times people want to, you know, when we get sober, we want to say none of it was great.
Right.
And it had some of it had to be great.
It was.
And then it stopped being great.
It was. You know, it was. And then... Well, I remember I was at a party. You know, it was great. I mean, you know, my parents were kind of loose hippies in some ways. Not that I was around pot a lot, but I definitely had access to it, and the kids I grew up with had access to it. So, you know, we were smoking. But then, you know, what really changed is when I went to a party and I was in early high school, and this cholo passed me a joint, and I smoked it, and it was like, boom, it hit me like... more than anything else. And you know, I was like, you know, what's in this? He's like, oh, it's a primo. You know, I forget the war. I mean, we could go on all day for war stories, but I just remember how I felt. It like kind of completely separated me from the party at that moment. And I was like kind of on my own as this.
Primo has PCP in it, right?
No, it's just crack and weed.
Oh, crack
and weed.
As far as what I,
crack and
just
weed.
Just a few, you know. That's something I never did. But that was like the night I remember of it being, you know, of marijuana being the social drug, and then me doing that, and it like I was like in the corner all by myself, hating myself, and that was it. Actually, brought me to that place of how I really felt about myself very quickly. So I was like, oh, I'm home, in this way where it's like, okay, this is really me. You know, this is how I really feel about myself. And then from there, it was this constant battle of of doing it not too much for many years and kind of hiding it from everybody. You know, I was a crackhead when I started my band, Ozomatli. I was using it. No one knew, though. I kept it, you know, I completely hid it from everybody because that was unacceptable in my band. You know, marijuana, oh, that's cool.
Right, but crack. You know,
yeah, but crack is just, it's kind of, for me, was one of those things where I suck. I really suck because I do this, and no one could know because this is actually the worst thing that anybody could ever do.
I had a lot of shame right from the beginning about the crack.
Yeah, and I don't know if it was about crack. It could have been, you know, about... you know, the shit I thought about sexually growing up.
Oh, and we just got the dump button.
It's okay. It's all right.
We're not at HBO yet.
If you just tuned in, you are listening to KLEAN Radio. Give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. The hashtag tonight is Rockers in Recovery. Okay. He dumped it.
It's only look. It's a conservative radio station.
5%.
Yes.
5%.
And we're actually going to take a collection. And so we're passing the basket. And so if you just tuned in, you are listening to KLEAN Radio. And I think it's very important you just spoke about, because it's really cool, Andrew, in a sense. He's sharing this one extreme, the greatest joint.
Right.
Like the greatest joint. And I think everybody out there that's listening that's a drug addict or an alcoholic is going to get this. But I want the family members and I want people that don't understand addiction. The two extremes you had, one, greatest high, weed.
Right.
Second, primo.
Well, I mean, obviously people don't get addicted to something that makes them feel terrible in the beginning, right? It's like, you know,
let me tell you, I had to learn how to like alcohol. I didn't love it right away. Really? I had to really learn how. The first time I drank beer, I said, I am never drinking this.
Cheetah, when you're three, that doesn't count.
Yeah, that's true, too. That's true. Yeah.
Your taste buds change a little bit over time.
That's actually a very good point. Good
and your point. Mother putting it in the bottle didn't help. That wasn't like, God. You know.
My mother listens to the show. So, you know, definitely not the case.
Your mother was the best mother ever, from what I've heard.
She put up with me.
She saved your life.
She saved my life. Yeah. So if you just tuned in, it's KLEAN Radio. We're talking about rockers and recovery tonight. But we're also talking about what it's like at the beginning, because I think, you know, you've been sober quite a while now.
Yeah, 11 years. 11 and a half years.
That's amazing. You're in this worldwide band, Ozomatli, Grammy-winning band. And
you guys are huge, right? Yeah. I mean, worldwide,
we've been to 50 countries. We've been together 19 years.
That's pretty big. 50 countries.
We don't have any hits. So when you say, what's your song? Like, I don't have something to sing to people. So
right.
Hey, Fluffy. Not that big.
So it's like Wham.
Yeah. No, Wham had a tune. What was it?
Yeah, Wake me up before you go, girl.
Oh, only is go, go.
Go, go.
Yeah, go, go.
Yeah, he didn't get it right.
But you know what? I mean, huge band. That you've been in 50 countries. You've been all these things. So people see you and you're married.
I am married.
You had an amazing Father's Day, and people see this picture.
Wow, you just pissed off like a lot of women around the world.
But it's not the picture of what was.
No.
You know, and I think, and it's like, people see you, they're like, I can't see it.
They can't think, but that's the thing is, what's crazy is now, you know, I get this opportunity to, you know, connect with people in a way that, like, especially like the drug addict on the street, for instance, it's asking for change. You know, there's times where I'll just sit there and start talking to them, and it's instantly they know I've been there, you know? It's like, you know, I can look at them and just be like, yo, what's up? You know, you're going to any meetings anytime soon? You planning on it? They, you know, the guys on the streets, they know this is there, and they've probably been there and in and out, you know, through help. And but the average person doesn't see that.
Right.
Obviously, yeah.
And it's an amazing transformation. Right. And it's almost to the point sometimes where people say this to us, how could you have been a drug addict? Yeah. I just don't see it. And that's the amazing thing to people out there that are listening. There's so much hope. You know, what you see, the unfinished product of that child of yours, that family member of yours that's addicted.
Yeah.
We have no idea how the sky's the limit.
Right.
And in your case, I mean, like I said, and that's the significance to me of what you're doing now is you're doing it sober. You've hit this amazing band, you know, and 50 countries. That's amazing.
Yeah. And unfortunately, I wasn't clean for many of them. I mean, I remember going to Amsterdam the first time sober. I was 6 months sober.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Imagine that. But you know, I get off the plane and all I ever knew there was, you know, the cafes and even looking for drugs on the street. I mean, I did that all there.
It's actually been reformed a lot. I was back there fairly recently.
Oh, really?
Like they closed all the drug parks and everything.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, a lot of reforms going on.
Damn those Amsterdams.
Amsterdams.
But you know what's crazy about, you know, Dutch life or whatever that I learned clean was what a great country to have a child in. Like I started going to parks. I started going to museums and art, you know, and art museums and Anne Frank Museum, and that I had been there probably six times prior, you know, and then my seventh time there, I'm finally clean. And I had no idea this even existed.
There's such great art in Amsterdam. Yeah. It's unbelievable.
That's an amazing point you bring up. It's you know, when you're drinking and you're using and you're getting high, you're not going to museums.
No.
You know, you're not saying, you know, when you wake up in the morning.
Unless they're open at 3 a.m.
Right, yeah. Unless that's where the crack is.
Yeah.
Unless
they have an open bar.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, that's, right, but unless, and you wake up and you get sober and you're like, oh my God, I live in, there's so much to do.
Yeah.
Right. I could find out what I like. I could find out who I am. If you just tuned in, you're listening to KLEAN Radio. We're in studio tonight with Wil-Dog Abers from the band Ozomatli. We were talking about in the beginning about raising the bottom and that people don't have to hit such a bottom. And let's get to Rod in L.A. Welcome to KLEAN Radio, Rod.
Hi, it's Rod, the interventionist from L.A.
Oh, hey, Rod. Hey, Escudo. How are you doing?
Hey. And you know what?
Now what?
I walked into a room with people that worked at a trust fund, and they asked me, what are you going to tell him? He just inherited $258 million. I'm like, it doesn't matter what he has.
Right.
It doesn't matter how he lives. It matters how he feels about how he lives. And I learned to like hold up like this an imaginary mirror and point out, you know, to the addict what I saw. It's an emotional, spiritual, physical, mental bottom. And I just had to point those out without insulting him.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, there's a lot of rich drug addicts dying every day. So, you know, having a lot of money is actually a really dangerous thing because you can cover up your addiction for a long time and, you know, get a lot of what you want.
Masquerade yourself as something else. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I just wanted to say that because you guys actually asked me that before, and I don't think I heard it, but there is a way to do mutual, raise the bottom and bring the addict to meet it without dragging him down.
Cool. Well, great, Rod. Glad to have you listening, and thanks for the input.
And, Rod, do me a favor. I want you to hold on or call back at about 6:30 when we have a little bit of a surprise. So give us a call back or hold on, okay?
I'll hold on. I'm good.
And if you it's Rod Espudo. He's amazing.
Jimmy just wants to make sure he keeps listening for another 8 minutes.
I want to make sure we have one.
We got one listener. Yeah. Yes.
There we go. And like I said, you're listening to KLEAN Radio. We're in the studio tonight with Wil-Dog Abers from the band Ozomatli. And the hashtag tonight is Rockers in Recovery. And we're all influenced. We grow up influenced by, you know, musicians. And we, you know, when we're sober, we know the sober musicians. You know, and I mean, this has a lot of influence on whether, I guess, you're a musician or not. When you know of musicians that are sober, does that have any effect?
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. The good thing is there's in my band, there's a few musicians that are sober. So I have it around me constantly. And, you know, none of our programs kind of overlap very much. Which is fine, but I just to know that we're there, they're there, and we actually have dry dressing room, dry bus now. But you know, yeah, I mean, you know what? I don't play a lot outside of my own band. I mean, I sing Mexican music on the side. There's a lot of drinking in that culture. Luckily, drinking was never my main thing. That was always what I did if nothing else was around. But yeah, I mean, if I do play in a group that's outside, I gravitate automatically towards people who are either completely normie that don't abuse it or completely clean. It just happens.
There was a really cool interview with Trent Reznor from Nine Inch Nails the other day. I was reading, and he was just celebrating 18 years of being sober.
Wow.
And he was like, you know, the only thing I regret about getting sober is that it took me so long for me to get sober, and now I've had to make up, like, over these 18 years, all that time I wasted.
Oh, it's you like, know, yeah. I remember being 30, I was 30 when I got sober, and I felt like I had to, you know, grow up, and I still felt like I never got to live that high school experience. You know, I'm a high school dropout. I never got to go to the prom. I never, you know, my whole 20s, I felt like I was just in a cloud. And like I would hang out with clean and sober people that were in their 30s that have been sober for a long time. And I felt like, and they were like 10 years younger than me. And I felt like, you know, they were so much smarter than I was.
A lot of people actually become addicts from the trauma of going to the prom.
Yeah. Oh, good. Okay. That's,
but so, you know, it's extremely important though what you just brought up, because I call it the Wonder Years. You know, I used to watch the show The Wonder Years and go, those weren't my years.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't have those years, and alcohol and drugs for a lot of us really took away those times.
The Wonder Years weren't Jewish, were they?
And,
why did you relate to that family?
You know, because it's called projecting. But we would have these, you know, we get sober, and we have to learn how to start doing stuff again.
Yeah.
You know, we have to learn how to start, you know, doing all those things that we never, that alcohol and drugs were there to. And it's terrifying. It's a big reason I think a lot of people relapse, Andrew. They get sober and life is there.
Right.
They don't get to say no. Right. You know, they're a grown up with a kid's mind.
And then all the people that you grew up with that didn't go down your dark path or have all this like great things happening in life. Well, that seems like it is, you know, it's all perception. Like, our caller said, you know, about how you feel about yourself, Rod, right? Rod.
Yeah, Rod. Yeah.
Like Rod said, you know, but you know.
You can remember the caller's name, but you can't remember my name. Now
my
self-esteem is just like really
low. It's on the computer screen.
I was reading.
He's reading it.
I did learn how to read the three-letter word in the last 11th year.
Three-letter Scrabble champion.
So let me ask you both a question, because Andrew's actually one of the biggest fans. I mean, he's a bigger music fan I have never met. You're a musician. I'm sure you're a music fan. If you had to say, you know, we have these heroes. You mentioned Trent Reznor being obviously a sober, you know, I guess in a sense it's you think it's amazing what he's done being
He's one of my favorite artists.
And a hero, and he's sober now.
Yeah.
Do you have any of those?
Wow. That are musicians?
Yeah. Clapton.
Come back to me.
I'm going to come back to
you. Yeah, come back to me.
You'll take
that.
A pass.
Not off the cuff at the moment. Let me think about that.
Because it is Rockers and Recovery Night.
Yeah.
And I think it's important we also talk about this, because we're actually going down to this event. I think a lot of times when people get sober, they think this is it. I'm dead. You know, the rest of my life will be spent in this 12-step meeting.
Right.
You know, they don't realize that we're out there having fun.
Right.
You know?
Well, and we want happiness now.
Right.
You know, as soon as we get sober and clean, we want, like, when's it going to happen to me? When do I get what I'm supposed to get? You know, and I go through that. I still go through that. You know, I think the difference is now is that I realize that everything's going to come in time. And, you know, if I put one foot in front of the other and I do the right things, maybe what I want I won't get, but what I'm supposed to get, I will get to.
Remember, in America, it's the right to pursue happiness. It's not necessarily the right to have happiness.
Right.
So give us a call if you just tuned in. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. One of the things we're going to talk about when we come back is, you know, this whole marijuana thing and edibles and kids. And I'd love to get your perspective. You're a parent now.
Yeah.
You don't smoke pot anymore. No. I'd love to know Rod. That was for you, Andrew.
I'm the only one that's getting names right tonight.
Rod's hanging up in less than 2 minutes, by the way.
This is Clean, the wet brain show.
And we have a very special thing when we get back. If you just tuned in, you're listening to Clean Radio. So give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. The hashtag tonight is Rockers and Recovery.
It should be name-finding deficit. Hashtag name-finding deficit.
That's exactly right. go to facebook.com/cleanradio. Check us out. We're going to be in Washington at the end of the week. We're going to have a lot of fun out up there. Said it right, Andrew. So go to cleanradio.com. Find out where we're going to be. Twitter us at cleanradio. Check in with us all week. We're going to have a special event. We're going to be giving away shirts. We want to meet you, so please come down. It's Rockers and Recovery. It's going to be this Thursday night. We'll be back in a couple seconds at Clean Radio.
Stay tuned.
Are you or someone you care about addicted to drugs or alcohol? Addiction ruins lives and destroys families. Bring an end to the pain and suffering by calling KLEAN Treatment Centers. KLEAN has helped people from around the world break free by not only treating the addiction, but the underlying causes and providing vital aftercare so people can get clean and stay clean with no gimmicks and no false promises. If you need immediate assistance or just have questions, call KLEAN Treatment Centers for guidance. A much better life awaits.
Back to Andrew Spanswick and Judah Friedman.
Welcome back to Clean Radio, in studio tonight with a rocker in recovery who's also known as Breakdance Willie. And I love that nickname. I always wanted that type of nickname.
I'll give you that nickname, Breakdance Judah. You want that?
Yeah, no. but he, look at him, Wil-Dog Abers from Ozomatli. He looks like a Breakdance Willie.
Yes.
And
you want a battle?
No. Okay. You know,
man.
But I want to tell
do
you
that after the
just
show,
so
though.
People
I got
out
some
there
cardboard
know,
out
just
back.
So people out there know, Will is in one of the biggest bands in the world, a world band, Grammy-winning band, Ozomatli. And you're Jewish. You're in a very
half Jewish. Waist down.
It's Jewish enough. And, but you know what's funny? You say that is that. Oh God. And what's funny you say that is because you're a break dancer, and a lot of you know people don't realize we have a lot of rhythm. Our people.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Actually, I'm doing a. Can I just a little shameless plug?
Please
here.
Go for it.
I'm doing a thing with this organization called CARS. It's a nonprofit Jewish organization here in L.A. And I'm doing a series of three concerts, and they're pairing me up with an African-American artist here in L.A. Named Jarrell Perry, and we're doing three shows, one at the Echoplex, one at Fado Do's, and the other at the Wilshire Boulevard Temple in September.
Wow. And that's amazing. And I'll tell you what, any help we could offer for that, you let us know.
Okay.
Patrick, there's nobody that shoots better video. We'll be there anytime, any assistance we could be.
Thank
we'll
you.
Open
appreciate
up in the
that.
Last show reading part of the Torah. Yes.
Break
dancing at the same time.
Oh, okay.
And so if you just tuned in, you're listening to KLEAN Radio. Our ombudsman, Buddy Totten, is in. And,
no pun intended.
No pun intended. And it sounds better than the budsman.
Yeah.
And
isn't it omnibudsman?
It's, yes. And okay. But it's also very special tonight. Buddy Totten has 6 years of sobriety today,
yeah!
And we wanted to wish you a happy birthday.
Dun, dun, dun,
happy
dun, dun,
birthday dun, 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 to you. You sing
Sapo Verde is tu.
And that's Buddy Totten, 6 years sober. Oh, Rod is still on the line, Rod. So that was the special thing. Rod, are you there?
You know what?
Yes, what?
That was worth the 20 minutes of what I just went through with you guys. To know that my beautiful brother with a beard is celebrating six.
That's amazing, right, Rod?
That.
And both of you,
oh,
both
you have no idea.
Both Rod is majorly influential in helping Buddy get sober, use your interventionist.
Yes, that's right.
And and Will is also, you've known Will a long time.
Yeah, I've known Will for a long time. I got in touch with Will through a good friend of mine. And can you hear my mic?
No.
No, your mic's not working.
Don't worry about it, Buddy.
Can you hear him over there?
Don't worry about it, buddy.
Go ahead, you know.
We gave him a birthday. We just didn't give him a mic.
It's
all right.
There we go.
All
right. There's only so many good things that happen.
And I want to tell you something out there. The people that are listening out there tonight. Buddy's an amazing story. Buddy, I know Buddy's story. I've known Buddy for a long, long time.
He's got a mic now. Let him say something.
Go for it, Buddy.
Right. Well, no, it's amazing to have Rod on the phone and to have Wil-Dog here in the studio because these guys are directly responsible for saving my life. I mean, Rod is my interventionist, and then once Rod intervened, Rod did what he could, and then I got a few bright ideas, and I was just swimming out there, and then a really good friend of mine, my old bandmate, my old band leader, he always stuck with me even when I was going through total madness. He put me in contact with Wil-Dog. And I never even met Will, and Will immediately put me on the phone with Music Cares, Musicians Assistance Program, and literally 2 hours after talking to you, after talking to Will, I was enrolled in a sober living that was like 2 miles away from where I was living.
That's great.
In a garage. I was living in a garage with walls made of furniture blankets. And I went from a garage and from two phone calls, my friend and then Will, to living in a beautiful Victorian sober living within 2.5 hours.
That's amazing.
It's an amazing story.
And Music Cares is a great organization,
yeah.
By the way.
Oh, they're awesome.
And we work with them a lot. And,
they saved my life.
Yeah, they've.
And I don't think, and Rod's on the phone, and I think, Andrew, a lot of people don't realize this, and we talk about this a lot. A lot of people don't realize that they do have benefits. There's help out there. A lot of people think, you know, the job of an insurance company is to not pay. They don't want you to know that you might be eligible to get help.
And that's one of the things that we're actually really good at. Even if you think you don't have benefits, you know, call up KLEAN and let us actually help, you know, go through your benefits. We have people that are specialists that, you know, actually read what are called EOBs or explanations of benefits for the 2007 and something plans that are out there. Right. So it takes, you know, somebody who's experienced and knows how to handle these people to get your, sometimes to pre-cert you and get you your insurance to cover your treatment.
I couldn't believe that. When I went into treatment in Pasadena, the map and Music Cares paid for the whole thing. And I was like, really? It's free? Like, I don't have to pay any money? Yeah, I couldn't believe it. I felt really special just, you know, day one going in there.
I don't think people realize this enough, that there is help out there. You know, it's like the mother calling me the other morning. It was amazing, the series of events, how she got to me. And then I was able to go to Andrew and have him say, let's do what we have to do. But there are a lot of people out there that are caring. And so if you're struggling out there, I beg of you, don't give up. You know, you might have been said no by many people.
Yeah.
Where you're talking to people in this studio tonight that are a bunch of, have been told no's.
We'll find a way.
We'll find a way.
We will.
That's exactly right. Yeah. So give us a call if you have any issues. It's 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. I'm actually
Can
really,
I go now?
You could go, Rod.
Yeah, Rod. No,
see you later, Rod.
Rod, safe interventions.
Love you all.
Love you, man. You couldn't DVR whatever you're watching.
Yeah, Rod,
there,
I'm going to call you Wil-Dog, and Wil-Dog is Rod. Have a good night, Wil-Dog. No, have a good night, Rod. And we will talk to you later. If you just tuned in, you are listening to KLEAN Radio in the studio tonight with Wil-Dog Abers from the band Ozomatli. And also Buddy Totten came in, who does a lot of our Facebook stuff. But we're having problems with the mic, Buddy. It's your six-year birthday. Don't worry about it, okay?
Thanks, man.
You just rest tonight, man.
All right, I'll just post online.
6 years sober. And the reason I wanted to paint the picture, because what you've spoken to me about, and Will probably saw what you were like 6 years ago, yeah. And we see it all the time.
Oh, yeah.
You're a vision of hope right now. I mean, you, in some way, you know, you're...
wow. I'm getting there, you know.
When I said it, Buddy looked at me.
It's a work in progress.
Buddy, when I said it, looked at me like, really?
Like, really?
That's the latest
Judaism. No, just so you know, Buddy gave me the look of like, really? Be honest, Judah.
And you were like, partly? Really?
Wow. No, but Buddy's an amazing man, and he's proved that sobriety works. So, Buddy,
absolutely it does.
Happy 6 years.
Thank you so much, you guys.
Can we sell tickets to the fight later? Like,
yeah. okay, so give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222.
A charity raising event for people that need treatment.
It's 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. What you just brought up is an important point. Yep. Will, you're in the music industry. You have this event coming up to help kids. And is there being enough? You know, there are so many sober musicians that we know of. And we could all say their names. They've broken their anonymity. Okay. Why is there no sober tour?
Interesting.
Why is there, like, with all the sober musicians that we know, a sober tour?
You know why?
There's all ages shows.
Well,
but
yeah. You know why? Because the only way we make money is when people drink.
Right?
Right.
Or because, there's either the door or there's the bar.
Right. They're getting you at one end.
You know? And
right.
Right,
so. You're right, and it's actually a good point that you're making. But I'm talking about even once a year.
That
you
would
know,
be, yeah.
You would think though that there would be enough sponsors to actually offset
Red Bull,
the
Monster.
Yeah,
I mean there
yeah.
are tons you know, of you know. I don't mean to give them free ads, but right. all of these you know, there's so many companies out
Those
there.
Those aren't even healthy, but at least they're not quite as addictive.
Right,
right. Well, Red Bull. I mean, would Red Bull really be your live without them being behind the bar?
Right.
You know, if you think about it, they've become a staple.
With vodka mixing and Red Bull.
And I think they probably make more money there.
I want to tell you something. I want to tell you a funny Red Bull story.
Unfortunately.
When I got sober, there was no Red Bull, right?
Right.
I never heard of Red Bull 15 years ago. And I found this thing called Red Bull, right? And I was like, I didn't realize that most people drank it with vodka. And I was at a place that they had free Red Bull. And I was like, I'm in heaven. I mean, like, as much Red Bull as you could drink, and bad decision.
Yeah, how sick were you after that?
I was shaking. I couldn't stop. I mean, 17 Red Bull. And
I love that feeling.
Let's get to a call. Let's get to Clyde calling from Portland, Oregon. Welcome to KLEAN Radio, Clyde.
Thank you. I just wanted to mention an herb called kratom. I know that you guys probably may look at it as just substituting one drug for another, but kratom is a It's a leaf that grows in the Malaysia, Thailand area that they've been using over there for hundreds of years. It's in the coffee family, and it's kind of a sedative.
Right.
It's not the coffee that comes out of the monkey's butts, is it?
No, nothing okay. like that. it's an interesting thing. It was actually outlawed in Thailand because it was putting a kind of a hurt on the opium trade over there. It's just a good substitute for if you're dope sick, if you're coming down, you just want to get away from opiates, heroin, or cocaine or whatever. Kratom can be found in a lot of herb shops and smoke shops nowadays.
Clyde, the question I have for you is, you obviously are very, very knowledgeable of Kratom.
Yes.
Did you use this for yourself? Were you coming off something?
Yeah, I was introduced to it a couple years back. I'm an addict or ex-addict, and I just was looking for something because I'm a type A personality and I just need to get relaxed a little bit. And it's got some medicinal qualities. It lowers blood pressure. It's just something you wouldn't want to use every day. But I urge people that are looking for a way to get, if you're looking a way to get off dope, you're looking to Kratom as something to help you. Celestial Seasons.
Okay, Clyde, we got to run, but thanks for the call.
Yeah, you know, I'd like to say that, I think the calls like that are important. There's a lot of people out there that are still looking for answers for things. Yeah. I mean, we have Ibogaine, which had a little renaissance for a little while, which is an hallucinogen that people are using in Mexico and Canada a lot for opiate detox. Yeah, the problem is for me is that, you know, just doing something like that on your own, if you're really addicted to something that seriously, you really need professional help.
And the after, too.
Yeah, and, you know, a lot of these things that people are using are still substitute drugs for their addiction. And there's a lot of, most opiate addicts and people who are addicted to opiates don't want to think about things. It's a lot about denying things and not thinking about things and wanting to feel very removed and relaxed and not conscious.
And what terrifies me, too, is I know a lot of people have a problem with the FDA.
Yeah.
You know, but here's a drug. You're getting it from Malaysia. I don't know about their...
Well, they've been having trouble getting stuff out of Malaysia lately, if you check.
That's not
a plane and a boat that didn't make it, so...
And if you just tuned in, you are listening to KLEAN Radio. It's Andrew Spanswick, and we're in the studio tonight with Wil-Dog Abers from the band Ozomatli. Before we get to the next call, quickly, I wanted to talk about pot quickly with you because that was your drug. Pot and crack. Crack was your drug.
I mean, all of them were.
How do you deal with it now that you're a parent?
Well, what do you mean?
Does it scare
you? That's a loaded question.
Does it scare you about, you know...
Does pot scare me?
With the legalization?
No. No, actually, no, it doesn't. I think, I might get killed here, but I'm actually for the legalization.
I'm not for legalization. I'm for regulation. And people sometimes think that legalization means no regulation.
Right. No, absolutely. So, absolutely. Yeah. Regularization.
It's as hard as the word recidivism.
It's as hard as Andrew. Yeah.
But I did see some, I read this article about where they're using, all these candy bar wrappers on it.
It's crazy.
Let's not do that.
Reese's Pieces.
Let's not have that.
Reese's Cup.
Well, that's just going to screw it up.
Well, Joe Campbell.
Well, you're killing with two birds with one stone. That's the whole point, right? You're getting your munchies and you're eating it, and you're getting high at the same time.
But the free market without some constraints will screw it up.
Yeah. It will. And I'm more about, you know, the decriminalization of drugs in general. So,
that's more important, actually.
Let's get to a call. Let's get to Alex calling from L.A. Welcome to KLEAN Radio, Alex.
Hi, guys. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for being here.
So I've been listening to you guys for a while. I thought you might help me with my issue. I've been hardcore smoking for 8 years.
Smoking what?
Dope weed.
Okay.
And it took me a while to get off of it. I finally managed to, and I've been off of it for about 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering if it would be a good idea to ever experiment with it, or do I have to completely stay away from it for a good while?
Well, Alex, how old are you now?
I'm 26.
And what were the reasons you decided to stop?
I couldn't get a hold on my personal life. I was like, grew up, Mm-hmm. I was always high.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I kind of needed to be a role model for my sister.
Right. Okay, so those reasons are why you shouldn't use it again. It's not about, like, you know, can I smoke pot or can I not smoke pot? You've already made this decision in your mind from experience that smoking pot puts you in a position where things that you believe are more important for yourself and for your family and the people you care about don't need to be lost because of smoking pot. Right. And it's the recognition of that that made you stop. And one of the problems when people get sober, then they, as soon as they're sober and they get everything back, if they're lucky, or they get a lot back, is they forget that it was the pot that was getting in the way.
Right.
And then they go back and they start, oh, maybe I can test it again. And then they start losing everything again. And they got to go through the process all over. That happens a lot. It's called recidivism. And we see a lot of it, or relapsing. And quite often that's what we deal with when people come into treatment centers, where they've gotten off on their own, but they haven't figured out why they can't stay off. And a lot of it's they don't make that connection, that, you know, really always remembering them daily why they're not doing it.
But Alex, other than just quitting, what else are you doing to help you stay off pot?
Nothing really. I gradually went off of it, and then 3 months ago, I just went cold turkey, which was really hard. I went through an emotional roller coaster in the last 3 months.
That's so important that you're talking about that, Andrew, that he's talking about the emotional withdrawal of going when you quit pot, because a lot of people don't think that pot has withdrawals.
Right.
Oh, no.
Yeah, no, withdrawal from that one, it can be really horrible.
Okay,
yeah,
Alex, a good suggestion I'm going to give to you is Wil-Dog goes to 12-step meetings.
Yeah.
That's how we got sober. I go to 12-step meetings. But there's also something that there's extra help sometimes. There's outpatient programs. You know, that you don't have to do this alone, Alex. That you could actually work on whatever issue got you smoking pot in the first place.
I mean, a big problem at 26, a lot of your drug use is probably related to social environments, like hanging out with people that you smoke pot with.
Well, that was one thing. All my friends smoke weed, so I stopped being friends with all of them because I had to. Otherwise, I couldn't stop.
Right. Yeah. So, Alex, what I would suggest is that maybe you do go to 12-step meetings, at least if nothing else, just to meet a bunch of people that are sober.
Yeah, absolutely.
And get a new group of friends. And then you'll also learn skills about how to hang out with friends that still use drugs.
I don't even know if Alex knows what 12-step meetings are. Alex,
no, I kind of know, but I have no idea how to access them.
Well, why don't you tell them?
Well, you can go on the internet. do you have access to the internet, Todd?
Yeah,
Alex.
Alex.
Alex, do you have access to the internet?
Yeah, I do.
Okay. There's Marijuana Anonymous. Yeah.
You can just type in Alcoholics Anonymous, put in your zip code, and meetings will come up automatically.
Okay, so just search engine it in.
Yeah, you're in LA, right?
Yes.
I'll tell you what, go to facebook.com/KLEAN Radio. Facebook.com/KLEAN Radio.
With a K.
With a K, right. And private message us. Tell us the call to the show, and we're going to hook you up with every meeting that
we'll send you a list of meetings.
We'll send you a list.
There's like 165 a day in LA, so.
And I'll tell you what, Alex, do us a favor. Call us back next week and let us know how you're doing.
Okay, sure thing.
Cool,
okay,
man.
Great.
Okay.
Thanks for listening. Thank you so much for the call, Alex. Yep. And that was Alex calling from LA. If you just tuned in, you're listening to KLEAN Radio. We forget that sometimes, Andrew. We forget.
It's not just with that, though. You know, it's funny because my brother used to work for Microsoft, and one of his favorite jokes he would talk about is people would say, you know, where do I find patches for Microsoft Word? He's like, Microsoft.com.
Yeah.
You know, and it's it's so obvious.
A little cynical.
But, but, you know, it's amazing sometimes when you're in something, you actually don't think of the most obvious solutions to find help.
Well, especially when it comes to yourself and helping yourself.
Yep.
That actually, for me, took some time that I am worthy of helping myself. I am worthy of getting the help as well.
And there's something else very important I want to talk about. I don't know what ethnicity, what background Alex was from, but there are many backgrounds, there are many ethnicities out there that still don't know what the 12 steps, you know, don't know what the 12-step meetings are.
Or now the variety of options.
Right, or the variety. And it's not in certain cultures.
And in some cultures, it's not okay to ask for help or put any kind of burden on any other human being.
It's like when we had Danny Trejo on the show.
Yeah, I mean, they talk about how certain cultures still try to cover it up and or remove people from the family completely.
Okay, Wil-Dog Wil-Dog has said you have to take this call, and I wanted to take this call, but we're so happy Todd is calling in. Todd from Salem, Oregon. How are you, my friend?
Hi, Wil-Dog Abers and Judah and Andrew.
Hey, Todd. Hey. How you doing?
I'm doing good. I got moved to medium.
Okay, so the people out there that are just tuning in, Todd's a loyal listener to the show. He is in the institution that they shot One Flew of the Cuckoo's Nest. It actually still is an institution.
And has a museum.
And a museum. And Todd, does that mean you're allowed visitors, Todd?
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you what, okay? Patrick and I are going to be up in Washington State for Rockers in Recovery at the end of the week.
Yeah.
And you know what? Maybe if we could get down to you, we will.
That would be awesome.
Can you put us on the pass?
Can you get on the website and sign up on the visitors app?
You know what? Patrick and I are going to do that this week. And Todd, we're going to do our best. No promises, but we'd love to come down and visit you.
Yeah, I'm at the Oregon State Hospital, and they rebuilt the facility. They raised the
bottom.
Yeah, they raised the old building.
And if there's any single women out there, Todd is looking for pen pals and visitors. So,
So Todd, congratulations. You're in minimum security right now. That's amazing. Ooh.
Medium.
Sorry.
Yeah, and I'm on lithium, and this is the calmest I've ever been. And
you sound great.
Yeah, he sounds better and better.
And how's school going?
School's going good. I'm working on Microsoft documents and... Just editing a lot of stuff that I've written.
You know what's so great, though, Todd, is that so many people think that institutions, mental health institutions, don't have a place in our society anymore, and that they're just like they were back in the 50s and 60s where people were basically locked away. But the truth of the matter is there is a need for long-term care, and you've benefited from it greatly, even though I'm sure not all of it was pleasant. But, you know, we really need to think as a culture how to reinvest in long-term acute care, because this idea that people can go into a hospital for 4 or 5 days and get heavily medicated and then be okay is just not true.
It's criminal.
Yeah, they have a 370 program now, and 370 means you can't legally aid and assist in your own trial. So they've been putting more of those people, getting them stable, and less of the the people that have the guilty except insanity.
Right. Well, one of the big problems is that, one, we've got this issue of my mic seems to keep cracking. Anyway, we have this problem of, one, criminalization of drug addiction and mental health. So most people that have drug addiction and mental health problems are in prisons. In fact, 90% of the psychiatric beds that used to exist in 1950 don't exist anymore. And plus the population has grown substantially.
Thanks, Reagan.
Yeah, right?
And then Andrew blames Nixon, though.
One of my homeboys is in Sheridan. It's a federal correction facility. It's not too far from here. And he said they just made that into a level 3, and that's where the inmates take care of the mentally ill guys, and they tell them to go get their meds and make sure they exercise and stuff.
Well, that's cool. You know, I'd rather psychiatrists and therapists were helping maybe than the guy that shanked my grandma. But,
but Todd, you know what the best thing in the world is that you're doing well. And Will was actually really excited. He was like saying, get Todd to call. Because it is. It's amazing. I love that you listen to the show. I love that you're getting help.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's quickly, sometimes slowly, right?
Right, yeah, it's a hard deal.
How's your friend, Todd?
It's Rod.
Rod. That guy. He was on suicide watch not too long ago, and we did have a successful suicide here about a month ago, and so they've been really watching those guys. He's in the DBT program,
right?
And they really keep those guys from hurting themselves and stuff.
Oh, good.
Well, Todd, what's the name of the site again that Patrick and I have to go look up?
It's the Oregon State Hospital visitors. I called one of your guys at the other number and told them to send you an email about that.
Okay.
Should I do that again?
Yeah, go for it, Todd. And listen, are you allowed to listen to music there?
Oh, yeah.
So, like how KLEAN Radio is the station of the... say the name.
Oregon
State Hospital. The band Ozomatli to become the band.
Todd, do bands ever play there?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah. We just had the Slants here, and they're an Asian band. They call themselves the Slants.
Oh, my God. Okay.
And they do a lot of donations and stuff, I guess.
Okay.
Wow. And they play for the military and stuff, but I guess they were here last Wednesday. They're really good.
Okay, I'll tell you what, Todd. We're gonna talk to Wil-Dog about this. And Todd, we gotta run, but we're gonna talk. That would actually be really.
We're gonna get Ozo up there.
I'll tell you what. Ozo, we should all go together.
Let's do it.
We'll totally sponsor. Let's make this happen. Let's do this.
Yeah.
Ozomatli,
what's the
Clean
biggest
Radio.
City closest to this place?
It's Salem, Oregon. It's
oh, it's in
Oregon.
Salem. Yeah. Okay, so. Damn, we never go to Salem.
We're gonna go, you know.
We go to Bend. We're calling it
instead of the witch hunts. We're calling it the recovery hunt.
You know, okay. We can fly into Portland and we can drive down.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, how far is it from Portland?
It's about three hours.
Yeah. Okay. Next time we play, we'll take my Airstream
in my truck. Yeah. I got a big giant truck and an Airstream. Let's make this happen.
Yeah. Let's make this.
This would be awesome.
Yeah.
You know, because I couldn't agree with you more.
No.
This is what the reason we're talking about this.
Judah, by the way, is the number one triangle player in LA.
Okay,
I just want to put it out
there.
The reason this is so important, I want to tell everybody out there that is listening, we're big into sober fun. We started something called the Clean League, a clean bowling league.
Okay.
We do it every Wednesday night at
Pins. I scored a 31.
Is that good?
No.
Andrew's bowled a 31.
But how much fun did you have?
I had a great time, but I got a 31.
Every Wednesday night in the Valley. Every Wednesday night at the Valley at Penn's in Studio City. It's on us. Come bowl.
I'm there.
Come eat 7 to 9:30, and we had fun.
I had more fun than I've had in a long time, except for the fact that I got a 31.
You know what? Okay. Progress, not perfection.
There was a lot of progress.
But here's the thing. If you bowl a 180, you can only go down. You bowled a 31,
right.
Man. I see upside.
I'm going to beat it next
upside.
Time. Yeah.
Wil-Dog Abers, where are you guys next?
I got to look at the calendar for that. I know I'm going somewhere this week. Oh, let's see.
I'll tell you what. How do people find you?
I was in Colorado last night. I'll tell you that much. they can find us on ozomatli.com. That's ozomatli.com. And I'm, or Ozomatli on Twitter. I'm El Gavachio on Twitter. Write me, talk to me.
I'm El Judah.
Wow, that'd be really cool.
That's like that Wiener guy that had that funny name. What was it?
El Wiener. Anyways, we got to run. And if you just tuned in,
what was it?
I don't know.
Whatever.
I want to thank everybody out there that listened to the show tonight. It takes a lot of people to put this show on. Wil-Dog Abers from the band Ozomatli, from the bottom of my heart, thank you.
Welcome back.
Anytime.
Yeah, it was great to have you on.
And I mean that, by the way.
Coming in.
Come bowling with us Wednesday night, everybody out there.
And we're going to go have a concert at the mental institution.
And I would love that. How cool would that
be?
It'll
be awesome.
And just come. If you're in trouble or anything and need help right now, give us a call. The number is 888-601-6040. That's 888-601-6040. I want to thank everybody out there. No matter what you're going through, there is hope. The conversation continues at cleanradio.com.
Are you or someone you care about addicted to drugs or alcohol? Addiction ruins lives and destroys families. Bring an end to the pain and suffering by calling KLEAN Treatment Centers. KLEAN has helped people from around the world break free by not only treating the addiction, but the underlying causes and providing vital aftercare so people can get clean and stay clean with no gimmicks and no false promises. If you need immediate assistance or just have questions, call KLEAN Treatment Centers for guidance. A much better life awaits.